So at first I would like to thank the organizers, specifically for the honor to give the last talk of the conference. This work is a work mainly between Uri and me. Uri has presented a poster on Monday, and as I heard, he was the first poster presenter. So I give the last talk, he gives the first poster, so we wrap around the whole conference is around our stuff. The topic of the, so this work has now been published last month, and I encourage everyone to have a look at the paper. It is about anti-lens supercurrents and superconducting spin valves. And since I know that everyone is already tired and everything, I will use the first slide already to explain what I actually mean by that. And then I hope I can raise your interest and be a bit more entertaining. So spin valves are certain type of magnetic interlayer devices. And in our case, we have a superconducting layer. And these magnetic interlayer devices, they have a certain type of magnetization behavior. So this sample here has a critical temperature of 5.8 Kelvin. And above this critical temperature, you see a typical curve as it is known from superconducting, from normal spin valves. And below the critical temperature, which is 5.8, and here we are at 5 Kelvin, you see a contribution of the superconducting layer, especially at 2 Kelvin. This is probably what you would expect. This is the same curve as you see from hard superconductors and many magnetic superconductor interlayer systems. However, the big difference is that this hysteresis loop is clockwise, which is wrong. You wouldn't think that could exist. You can see this also here in the crossing of the for the F of the curve for the upsweeping and the downsweeping field. So that means that usually, of course, when you have a superconductor or a hard superconductor, the reason that you get when you come from the higher fields, you go in this direction is because of flux pinning and the Lenz rule, which tries to preserve, to work against the change of a magnetic field. However, here, the change of magnetic field is enhanced by the currents. This project is a project which was all performed at CBPF. I'm not at CBPF anymore, I'm not with Rotter. Other collaborators beside Uri are Margida, who did the transport measurements, Marco Sosa, who helped with the creation of the samples, and Elisa, who is a big boss. And these are the people, the funding agencies that were somehow involved in the project. In the beginning, I will give a short introduction into spin valves, and then I will talk about how we grew the samples and how we characterize them, the techniques that we used, and then I will show you these magnetization curves of the different samples and how we analyze them. And then we will discuss the origin of the effect and compare it with other experiments. This will be non-conclusive, this discussion, but then I will give a conclusion of the talk. Spin valves are systems where you have usually two magnetic layers. You can do them with many more magnetic layers, usually two ferromagnetic layers and some interlayer in between, and somehow one of them is pinned and the other one is free. So when you sweep the field through one of these, you can switch around easily. The other one would need a much higher field. And then due to giant magnetoresistance, you can control the spin current in one direction. You can control the spin current. So this is how these devices became popular. But then there's another effect which is related to these systems. When you now change the angle between these two magnetizations and not do only anti-parallel and parallel, you can increase the triplet component if you have a superconducting spin valve. And this has currently is one of the topics for which these spin valves are used quite a lot to create a strong triplet component in superconductivity. Our spin valves are prepared by magnetron sputtering, and we grow them on silicon 111. Then we grow a tantalum layer, which is basically as a buffer layer. And then we grow iridium manganese, which is an antiferromagnet. And the reason for this antiferromagnet is only to lock the magnetization direction of the lower ferromagnet, which is permalloy. And above that, we put the superconductor, which is a niobium layer. And then again, a free permalloy layer. And then a tantalum layer to protect the samples so they don't oxidize. The this is wrong, this is 100 angstrom between 500 angstrom, is the size of the niobium layer. And then we characterize them with X-ray reflectivity, and you can see the results here. And specifically for the thicker samples, and these are the samples where we find these strong magnetization curves, the quality is quite good. We have very low roughness values of 3 to 1 angstrom for the different interfaces, so we have very clean, sharp interfaces. These are the TC measurements. So you can see now that when you make a thicker layer, the TC grows. So below 200 angstrom, we haven't measured any TC because we only measured down to 1.8 Kelvin. And then the TC is going up, which is due to coherence length and proximity effect. Then above a niobium thickness of 250 angstrom, at 300 angstrom it starts, that we can actually see the magnetization in the magnetization curves. And now we come back to the same picture that I showed you already in the beginning. So this is now for a niobium layer thickness of 500 angstrom, so the thickest of the samples. It's where the effect is the strongest. So you can see here the spin valve as it should be. Then you go below TC, which is at 5.8 Kelvin, and then you see the contribution from the superconducting layer. And this contribution is now in the wrong direction, as you can best see by these crossings, which we found in all of our samples. So these hysteresis loops are fully reproducible, and we have created a number of samples which show this effect. So in the upper row now, you can see the magnetization curves of the samples 300 angstrom, 350, 400, and 500 angstrom. And for different temperatures. And here you can see the crossing. If you blow that up, you would also see a crossing. You see this in all of the samples that are close to CC. When you now subtract the ferromagnetic contribution by just taking the lowest temperature curve where you still have the normal spin valve behavior, then you can get the pure superconducting contribution, which is the second row. And the first thing that one might recognize is that the reversible state here is not always of the same sign. That changes from sample to sample. However, when you now see the initial magnetization curve, so always when we cooled down to a certain temperature and then we started the measurement, then we had always a strong paramagnetic response in the beginning instead of a diamagnetic response, which you would expect from such a system. So this is, of course, very strange. And the first thing that we thought when it was part of Udi's thesis, and when he came with the first curve of that type, we were quite sure that this is surely a measurement error because it just doesn't make a lot of sense. However, we could convince ourselves that it is not a measurement error. One of the reasons I've already mentioned that several times is that we see this crossing. So it would be very strange if the magnetization direction in our measurements is wrong on one side of the curve, and then it's right in the middle, it changes during the curve. That would be very strange. Of course, we have measured also in the same equipment and the same people many other samples, which are also ferromagnetic superconductor interlayer systems, which show the behavior that we would generally expect it. And we were only able to reproduce this effect in this sample family and another one which is very similar, which I will not be talking about here. So the first question that one might ask, because this kind of messes with the ideas of how things work in a superconductor, how is the magnetic field guided through the superconductor? And is it guided through singular vortices, or do we have some macroscopic supercurrents, or do we have giant vortices like in the paramagnetic Meissner effect? And we can actually do such an analysis relatively simply if we look at the zero field magnetization of our samples. Then we can see how much is the sample magnetized. We know the dimensions of our samples. And then we can calculate the distance between two vortex in the linear direction. So we only take one dimension because we do not know how far the vortices enter into the ferromagnet. So this is the best way of not putting too much information into it. And then we come to these values of distances between vortices. So in the case of the 500 angstrom sample, we are something like 50 angstrom of the distance between two singular vortices, which is of course not realistic. When you have a psi zero of about 350 angstrom, then this would not be, even if they would be stapled, it just wouldn't work, just not enough space in the sample. So from that, we know that obviously the vortices or the supercurrents carry more than one quantum of flux. And we can now ask, what if there is a connection to the triplet formation? Because triplet formation is something that is often found in samples which are somehow similar. So this is something that if we have vortices in the sample, then of course the vortices are not all aligned in the same direction as a ferromagnet is magnetized. Instead, you will have, due to the pinning centers, you should have a bit of an angular mismatch. And this is actually what can create a stronger triplet component. So it might actually be that this is somehow related. However, this doesn't explain, or at least I don't see it, the anti-lens behavior. So, and now we come to the part of the talk where I try to give you an idea of what might be happening without explaining it too well, because we do not understand it at the moment. So if you now have our sample, now you remember, you imagine that you sweep up a magnetic field. What you would expect is now that you get supercurrents which try to expel the field, which is obviously not the case. Obviously, the opposite happens. However, we know that if we create in any way triplet pairs, the order parameter from the triplet component will survive in the vortex center, while the singlet component obviously will not. So if we now imagine, if we now accept that somehow we would get a situation in the contrary direction, which might be somehow thermodynamically more stable, then we would have in the middle a strong triplet current, which then would explain why we have a higher field density than we should actually be allowed to have in the samples. So then the question is, of course, when we now continue with this sweep, why do we build then anti-vortices that somehow decrease this effect? And why, as this is, we do not know why that is the case. So we have no conclusion for this anti-lens behavior. But it is really important to note that the triplet component shouldn't vanish in the center of the vortex. And I'm not aware of, we tried to find some work on that. Maybe somebody knows here of a good theoretical work on these on such systems, how the vortex behave, how the vortices behave. We didn't find any of that. So it is also interesting to note that there are studies of similar systems, like the one from Edgar, who gave a talk yesterday, where you actually find effects which are quite, they are not similar, but they are equally weird. So yesterday, you remember when Edgar was talking about the vortex flipping, and this is also a thing that is very difficult to understand how this might happen. So this is certainly something that is quite similar. So I talked a bit quicker than I actually wanted. I'm already at the conclusions, but I think that it might be not too bad because people here seem to be quite tired. I saw some people starting to sleep. Some people are still sleeping. So to summarize that, we have grown these spin valves with the superconducting interlayer. And the samples above, or with 300 angstrom or above, show this strong contribution in the superconducting phase of the niobium layer. And they all show this clockwise hysteresis loop, which is very puzzling, which means that the supercurrents enhance the change of the external magnetic field. And we could show that the field density is so high that singular vortices can be excluded as a possible origin. And there might be a possible connection to the triplet component. And thank you for your attention.
Okay, thanks.